Hello, and welcome to Why API Security is Critical to Digital Transformation Success. Today's webinar is sponsored by No Name Security and produced by Actual Tech Media. My name is Scott Becker. I'm from Actual Tech Media, and I am delighted to be your moderator for this special event. Now, before we get to today's great content, we do have a few housekeeping items that will help you get the most out of this session. First off, we want this to be an informative event for you, so we encourage any questions in the questions box in our webinar control panel. Not only will we have team members responding to questions during the live event, but we'll also have a dedicated Q&A session at the end of the presentation where we'll discuss in greater detail some of the top questions that you ask. The Q&A panel is also the place to let us know about any technical issues that you might be experiencing. A browser refresh will fix most audio, video, or slide advancement issues, but if that doesn't work, just let us know in the Q&A and we will provide further technical assistance. Second, in the handout section of your webinar control panel, you'll find that we're offering several resources. I'd especially like to call your attention to three PDFs from No Name. There's an overview document about No Name, there's a white paper introduction to shift left API security testing, and there's an API security testing for dummies book. So I encourage you to access those resources now and share them with your friends and your colleagues. Third, at the end of this webinar event, we will be awarding a $300 Amazon gift card to one lucky registrant. Of course, you must be in attendance during the live event to qualify for the prize. Official terms and conditions of today's prize drawing can be found in the handout section as well. Just scroll to the bottom and you'll find the prize terms and conditions link there. Finally, one of the best benefits of this event is the opportunity to ask a question of our expert presenter. So to help encourage your questions, we have a special additional prize for you. It's another Amazon gift card, this one for $50 for the best question. At the end of the event, we'll look at all the questions, pick out the very best one, and contact that prize winner later. And with that, let's get to today's fantastic content. So it's my pleasure to introduce you to our presenter today. We have Philip Verloy, who's field CTO for EMEA at No Name Security. Philip, great to have you here.
Thanks very much, Scott. Looking forward to guiding you through some of the shift left content we have for you today.
Well, we're looking forward to it too, so I will turn the floor over to you.
Perfect. Yeah, so what I wanted to spend the next 30 minutes or so on is focusing on API security and how it relates to your potential success in digital transformation, meaning there's many, many reasons, of course, why companies are looking at digitizing their environment. Maybe you want to find some efficiency gains, or maybe you want to find a competitive edge, or maybe you want to exchange data between partners, or add some new functionality to maybe mobile applications or existing portals and so on. So we keep seeing this push to not only attract developers and have them build out great new functionality from a software perspective, but also at the same time, we're seeing this low code, no code approach whereby citizen developers are sort of being enabled to digitize some of these existing processes that that exist in the physical space today. This all leads to a lot more software usage. Of course, it has some ramifications from a security perspective. So that's sort of what I wanted to dive into today. So before we talk about digital transformation specifically, if we take a step back and look at the IT department, so I guess it's sort of fair to say that until about a decade ago, the idea was that, or the discussion on a sort of daily basis from the business towards IT was that if IT didn't integrate into the business strategy, they were either going to go away, they were going to go extinct, or they were going to be completely outsourced to somewhere else because they were just looked at as a sort of cost center and not really strategically adding to the business as such. Of course, that completely turned around in the last couple of years, whereby the business is IT and IT sort of to some extent is the business. It's very hard to imagine any type of organization functioning without a decent IT backend. And through digital transformation, most of these processes are now running on the back of IT systems. So running them securely and making sure they're up all of the time is sort of business critical up in this point. Now, I think in 2011, if I'm not mistaken, this gentleman here, Mark Andreessen, sort of pointed out that software is eating the world. So sort of a different take on the same situation, whereby most traditional organizations are sort of digitizing their processes more and more. And he sort of predicted that if you don't follow this same path, you're gonna lose your competitive edge and sort of go extinct as a business over time. And we've certainly seen a big push towards that direction. Now, of course, from our specific perspective, it's not that software is eating the world. Well, that's certainly true. But on the back of that, what we are seeing is that APIs play a very, very important role in that digitization process. Reason being is that on the back of all of these connections that you're making between systems, so if you think about PSD2, for example, or open banking, whereby banks are sort of forced to open up their system so newer fintech players can integrate into their existing environments, that works on the basis of API-based integration. So digital transformation, but also things like multi-cloud adoption. If you think about a public cloud, it's really a big API that you talk to and consume services from, you know, might be through a portal or through some sort of scripting environment. But at the end of the day, you're communicating with an infrastructure API. Same thing for automation processes, being it, you know, on premises in a private cloud data center, or consuming these in the public cloud as well. So it's really APIs that are driving a lot of these possibilities and making that digital transformation process a reality. So from a security perspective, that unfortunately has also attracted some malicious intent, which is what we'll look at next. Now, of course, I can position this fact that everything works on the basis of APIs and all of this digital transformation won't be possible without it. But of course, I'm going to say that because that's sort of what I deal with on a day-to-day basis. Now, fortunately for me, the network really doesn't lie when it comes to looking at the type of traffic and the type of communication that's happening. So I have two proof points here, one from Akamai and one from Cloudflare, so both CDN type network environments. And what they did is they looked at the type of traffic inside of their global CDN environments. And Akamai found that 83% of the traffic that they see is API-based traffic. Cloudflare puts it a little bit less. They claim 54%. In any case, the majority of the traffic today through these networks is API traffic. So that's really the crux in how we connect these systems together, and that's really what we should be focusing on. As mentioned, it also attracts the wrong element to some extent. So we do see more and more API breaches. So all of these web-enabled, mobile-enabled services that you're offering externally, if they work on the basis of an API, that also means that that's a really nice entry point for somebody with bad intentions or wrong intentions to sort of figure out if he or she can manipulate that system and gain access to more data or functionality that he or she is not supposed to have access to. One of the most predicted sort of claims in this space is Gartner saying that by the end of last year, API abuses will become one of the most frequent attack factors, and that has really come to fruition. So if you look at some of the API breaches in the news, at the end of last year, we had Optus in Australia, for example. A telco provider, which had a breach of PII records. So I believe around 11 million PII records were stolen on the back of a badly authenticated, even an API without authentication, that you could just query and get all of these PII records out of without too much of a hassle. Early this year, there was this breach with 16 major car brands on the back of APIs. So a wide variety of API type of attacks, both in the services around the vehicle, the interconnectiveness of the vehicle, but also the vehicles itself, whereby you could remotely unlock, start, and track vehicles, including extremely expensive luxury brand vehicles as well. So definitely something to keep an eye out. And of course, you can't really mention anything in IT these days without talking about Twitter. So Twitter also had a data breach on the back of an API issue, whereby about 400 million PII records seem to have been extracted through the Twitter API. Now, of course, all of these systems already have some level of protection from a security perspective. So it's not that you build an API-enabled system and then just publicly enable it and make it publicly accessible so anybody can start consuming it. Of course, you already have existing security controls and existing security validation to make sure you keep attackers out of your environment. What we are noticing, though, is that traditional security controls, so think about things like web application firewall, API gateways, these systems really aren't matched with the newer capabilities that APIs can provide. So what I mean by that is, if you look at a gateway or a web application firewall, what these systems are really built to do is to look at transactions. So can we see a transaction happening towards an enterprise web application, for example? And during that transaction, can we detect things like a SQL injection type attack, for example, which they absolutely can. And you can build static rule sets to make sure those things aren't really possible. Now, if you try to match that with an API, the story becomes a bit murky, because what's happening is that an API has a certain backend business logic built into it. Now, it's very hard to capture a dynamic business logic into a static code set and then implement that from a web application firewall perspective. So it's really, really hard to codify all of these unique API logics that you're exposing with a static security validation tool like a gateway or like a web application firewall. Furthermore, the types of API attacks that we notice most are these low and slow type of attacks, whereby there's a breach that happens over a longer period of time, whereby you sort of have to figure out from a security perspective, how can we identify the person attempting to breach my environment with the activity that is happening inside of my system? So you really need to be able to correlate these events over a longer period of time and then make sure and validate if that traffic is either as expected or potentially malicious. So that's sort of the mismatch that we are seeing with current security controls today. And that's why you sort of need a specialized approach when it comes to APIs. One example from two slides ago that I want to dive a little bit deeper into, which is a good example of a logic-based attack, is Coinbase. So this happened in February of last year. What happened in Coinbase is they had a trading API that you could consume through the application. And what they allowed you to do is to have a user have multiple accounts with multiple different cryptocurrencies. And during the transaction, you could switch from one account to the other. So what the security researcher in this case found out was that you could log in with an account that had a expensive cryptocurrency associated with it, start the transaction. So the API would validate that indeed this person held this expensive cryptocurrency, let's say Bitcoin. Then in the middle of the transaction, you could switch to that other account that held a cheaper cryptocurrency, for example, Shiba Inu. And what would happen is that the amount or the number of cryptocurrencies would be validated in the second phase against that cheaper cryptocurrency, allowing you to sell Bitcoin for the price of Shiba Inu. So these types of logic validation mismatches or attacks are almost impossible to see through traditional security control. So this is really something you need to validate over time. And also you need to avoid as much as possible before you put it into production, which is why we focus also on shifting left and testing those APIs before releasing them into the wild. Of course, if you look at an API from an, let's say, networking, security, IT perspective, it looks quite simple. You have maybe a mobile application like Coinbase, and what you do is you ask something in the app, you query something, maybe your account, and you get an answer back from the service. The application could be built in one language, for example, TypeScript, and the backend or the API itself could be built in a completely different language or service like Node.js and Ruby, for example. So the nice thing about an API is that the contract that exists between the person requesting a service and the backend answering that service works on the basis of an API, which can be built in whatever language best suits that functionality at that particular point in time. So that makes it really, really powerful, but it also makes it accessible to people trying to misuse APIs. So if you take a step deeper or maybe look under the covers a little bit of this so-called simplicity, you will quickly find that it's actually quite complex. So if you look from the API consumer perspective, the mobile application, for example, of course, you're going to pass to these existing tools like your web application firewall, your API gateway, but you have a bunch of API endpoints that you can query or interact with from that system. And all of these endpoints expose different kinds of services, but they're also consuming different application services on the backend in their own right. So if you look at an API end-to-end, there's actually a great many moving parts from a security perspective that you have to take into account and then secure to the best possible extent to make sure that your services are not exposed. Now, because of this, this also means that APIs have quite a lot of stakeholders. So if you think about all of the teams involved with building an API product or launching an API service, of course, you have the API product team. So people who think up a new service. So let's say I'm going to digitally transform my environment. I'm going to offer new services either internally or externally for people to consume. What type of product or what type of service am I going to build? So the product team is sort of thinking through that. And then once they have defined the product, they will look at the development team to make sure that they can start designing and then implementing that solution so it can ultimately be offered as a service. To secure this new type of functionality, of course, you have to involve the application security team, you have to involve the information security team, the governance team, the platform team. So people have to decide where this API will run. Will it come from a public cloud provider? Will we run it in-house? Will we run it in a hybrid model? Where should we run it? In which geographical location? What type of functionality does public cloud provider A versus public cloud provider B offer in those different geographical regions, for example? So there's a lot of backend work that needs to go into thinking through how you're going to offer these APIs. So the question of who is ultimately responsible for API security becomes a little bit complex as well, because there's many, maybe too many stakeholders when it comes to being ultimately responsible for securely delivering an API. When we think about API security, we have to think about it in an holistic way, meaning you have to look at all of the stakeholders involved. So from an API security perspective, we look at developers, so pre-production, and we look at the security teams in production. So the idea is, if we want to offer API security, we have to both do it from a shift left and a shield right perspective. From a shift left perspective, it's about how can we make sure that we're not going to expose vulnerable functionality in production? So how can we reduce the attack surface as much as possible? Also, how can we look at lowering the remediation cost? If we capture bugs as early as possible in the development lifecycle, it's going to be much less expensive to remediate those issues than after a bug has been released in production, and certainly after it has been misused. So one example recently, I read on Sunday that Medibank in Australia again, so they had an API breach a while ago, and they're now being sued by three different law firms for $5 billion. So there's a lot of total cost associated with a potential API breach as well that goes way beyond fixing bugs in or after production. You also have to think about compliance. So what type of compliance frameworks are applicable to me as an organization? How can I exchange data internally, but also with external partners, for example? How can I eliminate bottlenecks when I think about testing? So the idea is, if I want to compete in, let's say, the global economy, I want to deliver functionality quicker than my competitors. So I need a system that won't slow me down. So if I'm thinking about validating security in pre-production, this has to be as smooth as possible. It can't really be another roadblock that a developer has to then deal with before he or she can push that code into production. Then it's also about the confidence. So how can we make sure that on day zero or day one, when we actually release the product, we are as certain as we can be that we are not sort of exposing our entire organization because we just added a new piece of functionality to our system. And it also needs to be continuous. Continuous from the fact that you can implement like bug bounty programs, you can implement like pen testing programs, but these are typically locked in time. So they will happen maybe once a quarter, once every month or so, but that's not in lockstep with the functionality that you're delivering, because typically we see that new functionality is sort of delivered on a continuous basis. So that means that that security validation has to also work on that same time frame, meaning continuously. Shield Right, also part of the No Name platform, less of a focus of the session of today. More than happy to talk about it after the session, but right now we're sort of going to focus on what can we do in pre-production. So if you look at pre-production and, let's say, developers, there's this interesting white paper from Jim Gray from Tandy Computers. So this is a fairly old white paper from the mid-80s. I was alive then, so I can quote it. So the idea there is that he looked at these highly fault-tolerant systems, these tandem systems, and they saw failures at customer sites, right? So even though these systems were built to be very, very resilient, extremely fault-tolerant and so on, they from time to time still failed. So what Jim Gray set out to do was figure out, well, what's sort of the ultimate root cause of this failure of my heavily redundant system? And he pointed to the software. So he said, looking at the software, there's bugs in this software which cause my system to fail from time to time. So what he then did is he looked at, well, when do these bugs occur? So what he saw was that when developers initially check in their code and say the functionality is built, gave it to their managers and said, I'm done, we can start building the next piece of functionality, they found typically one bug per 10 lines of code. Then when they ran the code through QA testing, QA approved it, it went on to the next stage, it went down to one bug for every 100 lines of code, so still quite a lot of bugs. Then after the code was in production, iterated a couple of times, then and only then did it go down to one bug per 10,000 lines of code. And of course you can say, well, yeah, but this is like waterfall development in the 80s. Now you have agile development and so on, so this will be a different story today. Well, actually, it's not, right? So this is a more modern example in the Applied Software Measurements book. So what was set out there is that if you look at when are bugs introduced into code, and what is the cost of remediating them at a certain phase of development? Of course, during coding is when most of the bugs are introduced, because that's when you're writing the code, of course. Fixing it during that initial coding phase is the same cost as developing the application, because that's essentially part of it, right? So there's no additional cost if we can catch this bug during the initial development. Then it goes into unit testing. So I have a piece of functionality that I've written, my simple unit, my simple function, I'm going to test it. And then, okay, four times as many defects are found during that unit test. But still, like the cost and the cost to fix them goes up 400%. Then if you look at functional testing, like how does these do these functionalities fit together if they interact with the rest of the system, if you have to fix it at that stage, it's already 10 times as expensive. If we release it into, let's say, production and have to fix it after the fact, then it becomes 640 times more expensive. So it's really down to, can we catch these bugs as quickly as possible, as early as possible in the development lifecycle? That's really the entire goal of the system, to make sure that you're not having to then go back and iterate at an extremely high cost to make sure that you're getting rid of these security vulnerabilities and software bugs. As I sort of alluded to before, if we want to shift left, we have to make it, or we have to do it in such a way that it is really no additional effort for the developer. Reason being is we're asking developers to do a lot. So a lot of the stuff is shifting left, meaning earlier in the development lifecycle. So things like testing, observability are all moving or shifting left earlier in the development lifecycle, which sort of makes them part of that developer workflow. And if we want to continue that without burning out our developer teams, then we have to do it in such a way that it can be completely automated. So if we focus specifically on API security testing and shifting that left, our system is really built on making that as seamless as possible from a workflow perspective. So that's really one of the design goals, is to make sure that we're not introducing too many roadblocks to consume that additional security testing functionality. To sort of get the full story, and Scott already mentioned the handouts, I believe there's a free chapter in the handouts as well on the API security testing ebook that we just published. If you go to that URL, you can find it as well. So the ebook really goes into depth when it comes to, well, how do I think through a security testing program? And why should I focus on specific tools when it comes to APIs? A quick snapshot on that specific tooling idea is, do you as a developer consider an API an application, yes or no? That sort of informs how you look at security testing that code. So if you say, well, an API is just like any other application, then of course you're gonna use existing tool sets. So things like static application security testing, dynamic application security testing, SCA, EAST, pen testing, and so on. But what we've noticed is that an API behaves differently from a traditional application, in a sense that an API talks to the backend application, is application functionality in and of itself as well, but it also presents itself as endpoints on the network. So there's a lot of ifs and buts when it comes to figuring out how my APIs work and if you can even reach those APIs from a security testing perspective. So that's why we have built this dedicated active testing solution that focuses on API-specific security testing. Of course, it's always going to be a collaboration. Because as I mentioned before, you have an API, but you also have your backend system, you have your infrastructure powering the application as well. So you really need to think through this in a holistic manner. But for API validation specifically, active testing was really purpose-built to make sure we can create and write secure API code. So from a functionality perspective, the way it was developed is from an API-first perspective, it only focuses on APIs, and it's meant for pre-production environments. Reason that I specifically mention it's created for pre-production environments is that it does attack your APIs when you're developing them. So it tries to create records, for example, in your database as part of the validation, as part of the security validation, that it runs through. So you shouldn't run this in production. Maybe you want to run it in a testing environment, but typically it runs in a pre-production type of environment. When we talk about APIs, it's about how can I get the full inventory of my APIs and how can I get all of my endpoints. So to inform us how your application works or how your API works, you upload an open API spec, for example, or you give us a Postman collection or a set of curl commands, something that we can use to then build an inventory and build the endpoints, but also understand how these endpoints work and how we can start to test them. So that's what we sort of call our industry-leading auto-reachability. We will go out and validate if we can reach those endpoints, and on the basis of authentication credentials that you give us, if we can manipulate these endpoints. So for example, an endpoint could be on the basis of a put command. Well, we need some sort of user that allows us to run that put command against that endpoint. So that's part of that reachability test as well. We have created our own specialized API tests on the basis of what we learned from production API security through the rest of the platform. So we've built API-centric attacks like, for example, Ebola attack. So the idea is we're not just doing static or dynamic application security testing. We're not just doing fuzzing and throwing random code against an endpoint. We have a really specialized tool that will go out and enumerate and build and learn how your API works. And on the basis of that, attempt a multi-pronged, multi-step attack. As mentioned, it's part of a larger platform. Today, I'm focusing purely on that testing aspect of it. Of course, the platform as such is much, much broader. So if you want to know about the rest of the API security platform, I'm happy to do that after this session as well. I'm now just going to take a couple minutes, not too long, to give you a very, very high-level overview of an active testing environment, and then we can move on to some questions. So let me share my screen. So you should be able to see my screen, I think.
I see it, Philip. Yep.
Super. Looks thanks, good. Scott. So this is the base graphical user interface if you log into the platform. So this is really focused on looking at your production traffic. So we can find things like misconfigurations in your API security model in production. This is our machine learning model that finds really sophisticated attacks. We have a data model that looks at what type of data am I exchanging across my APIs and should that be allowed in my environment. And we have the possibility to do or to simulate a reconnaissance of an attacker. So looking from the outside in, what can I already learn about your environment without being inside of the walls of your firewall? But as mentioned, we're going to focus on the testing piece. So testing is the pre-production aspect of it. So the way that works is at a high level, you tell us about the API that you want to test. The way that you do that is you give us some sort of source. So this could be an open API specification, as mentioned, could be many, many different things. If you have the production system already from Noname, we can use that as an input as well. But typically, you would give us some sort of description of what you're building. Then you point us to the base URL. So what is the system I'm currently running this API on? Because we will use that to validate reachability of those APIs. So once you've uploaded the spec, what will happen is you've uploaded the spec and you've given us some sort of authentication. We will then build this this inventory. So and then we will check if we can reach those endpoints. So on the basis of the API specification, we know the functionality. We know where it's pointing to. We will try to reach it, including using the methods, right? So we will do reading, we will do posting, we will do putting on the basis of the type of authentication you have given us. And then we build this full API inventory that we can then test against. So once we have the inventory and everything is reachable, What you do is you tell us what type of tests you want to run against the system. As mentioned before, we have these really dedicated no-name tests that are built specifically for API security. But of course, you can use external tests as well, like subtests, for example, and upload those to the system. And then we will run those tests as well. If you look at the no-name tests, for example, we run through things like, Ebola attacks. Can we do a coarse type of attacks? Can we do malicious file upload attacks, et cetera, et cetera? The way that that presents itself then is as a suite. So that's just our naming. So the suite is the combination of that source file, that authentication, and the tests that you want to run against it. If you run the test, so I can manually start a scan here, it will run a scan against the system and then show you where you still have some work to do in terms of securing those APIs and raising that profile. So for example, here, if I pull this one out, it says there's a high severity broken function level authorization on this specific endpoint. So if I click on it, you'll see the full timeline. So the idea is you see the full request and response that the system attempted. You can see the stages of the test, and then it will give you some sort of outcome. So the outcome here is that an anonymous user was able to successfully consume a request that should only be consumable through authentication. And it's this particular endpoint. So what you could do then is, as part of an integration, you could automatically open a ticket, a Jira ticket, for example, assign it to the right developers, and then they can go in and implement the root cause remediation that needs to be implemented to make sure that this doesn't escape into production. Now, the other quick thing that I wanted to point out is that this is manual. And I mentioned before, we want to make sure that this is not an additional step in the existing workflow of the developer. This needs to be as easy as possible to consume. So the way that we make that easy is by integrating into a CI/CD environment. So for example, let's say Jenkins. The idea would be that in Jenkins, you can consume the same thing. So if you run through your build pipeline, as part of your test phase, for example, you could reach out to no-name active testing. It would validate your security posture against that API. And in the console of the CI/CD tool itself, it would give you the same output. So you can, in your tool, without having to jump out of your workflow and consume a no-name portal, you can, in your existing tool, in your existing workflow, see the output. And then depending on the configuration you've set, so for example, we can say we want to break the pipeline if we encounter a high severity issue, and we want to continue with the build if it's only medium and low severity issues, for example. So that way, depending on your, let's say, taste of how much or how critical you want this to be, you can decide the sort of interactiveness that the developer has to deal with. And again, on the basis of that, you create an auto ticket in maybe Slack or maybe Jira, something else. So the actual implementation or the actual fix can be implemented on the back of that.
Hey, Philip, let me just break in here 1 second. A lot of people are having trouble seeing the demo. I'm not sure. Are you actually done with it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Is there more to the demo?
No. That's what okay. I wanted to show.
All right, great. Anybody who wasn't able to see the demo, we will post a recording. Apologies for the troubles there. We'll post a recording that will have the demo in it, so you'll be able to go back and go to that spot. So, sorry, Philip, go ahead.
Yep, no worries. So, So also happy to do like a deeper dive demo as well, if you would be interested in that. But let's move to the Q&A section, if that's okay.
Okay. Yeah, sounds good. Yeah, great demo. Such a good topic today too, because API security has become so important in an overall security posture. First question here: how much of a heavy lift would it be to implement the no-name solution for API security?
Yeah, so if you look at the pre-production active testing part first, that's what you saw during the demo. That's really it. So you stand it up. It works on the basis of integration with your existing CI/CD tools. It's really easy. So everything is API enabled as well. So you essentially consume our no-name active testing API through your existing CI/CD tools. And that's it. So it's really, really straightforward, not a heavy lift at all. From the production piece, what we do there is we integrate into your existing environment. So we would sit behind or integrate and get a flow of API traffic from your gateways, from your firewalls, from your public cloud environments, from your Kubernetes environment. We would listen to Kafka messages on your Kafka message bus. So whatever you can give us, and that's what we use to validate your API security. So on both production and pre-production, it's really, really easy to get started with this platform.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Next one here. Can the solution also block attacks?
Yeah. So from the production perspective, so the way that our solution is set up, and that's also one of the things that makes it so easy to implement, is that's completely out of band. So we do not sit in the transaction. So meaning if you have a mobile application talking to a backend system, Noname will not validate that transaction in real time to say, yes, no, this transaction is allowed. Rather, what we are doing is we are sitting out of band. We get a copy of the flow. And on the basis of that copy of the flow and our machine learning, we will decide this is good traffic or bad traffic. And what we will then do is we will ask that inline device, for example, your web application firewall, to block the attacker. So the idea is, you already have made an investment in inline security tools like a web application firewall. We want to extend the applicability of that existing investment by integrating with those tools and allowing those tools to react on our detection. So that's really how we block, even though we are a passive out-of-band system.
Okay. All right, super. Next question here, does the solution require me to share my potentially sensitive data to a SaaS service?
So the way that we look at that is everything that we do in terms of data crunching is in the customer's own environment. So we do not send API transactions to a central data lake or anything like that to validate. The idea is that each API that you've built is unique anyway. So there's not a lot of additional value in sending that data to a centralized authority to validate what is happening, because the functionality that GE builds is different from the functionality that Philips would build, for example. So that's why we can crunch that data and validate that data completely offline using a machine learning model that runs either inside of your own data center or inside of your own cloud account. But in any case, we never send data externally.
Okay. All right, excellent. Rohan is asking if API should be included in the risk management process. I assume the answer is yes, but I'm wondering, you know, if you can share anything about, you know, how much more important APIs are becoming, and how much more of a risk and an attack vector they've become as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So I always think about risk as a combination of like, what is my, what would the impact be of an attack like this? And what would the potential be of that attack happening? Like, how often would an attack like this happen? And if it happens, what would be the impact to my environment? So if you look at these recent examples with Medibank and with Optus and with those 16 car manufacturers, for example, the impact is rather big. And the thing about an API is that it wants to be externally accessible. That's the whole point of an API, is you want to be able to consume it from a mobile device or from a portal or something like that as a consumer, which means that from a risk management perspective, it's something that's accessible externally, And it potentially has a really, really big impact because it can talk directly through that API to your backend services and cause a lot of impact. Usually what we're seeing is a lot of impact around data extraction, PII data extraction. So it's definitely something that should be very, very high on your risk management assessment.
Great. Michael has a question about encryption. Should we not be seeing API traffic being encrypted so people can't tell what is there? What do you guys do as far as, you know, or what do you recommend as far as best practices with encryption, and what do you see out there?
Yeah, so the traffic remains encrypted. So that is absolutely the right approach. So the idea is indeed that traffic should be encrypted, although we do detect a lot of API issues, for example, with unauthenticated and unencrypted endpoints being accessible. But let's assume the data is encrypted, which it should be. The idea is the way that we get the data into our system is through interfacing with those inline tools like a web application firewall, an application delivery controller, a load balancer, a gateway, and so on. The idea would be the offloading of the encryption would happen on that inline device. We would get an unencrypted copy of the flow, including the data, and that's what we can then use to validate in terms of what type of data and is it sensitive, yes or no, you are processing without breaking the end-to-end encryption, because the actual communication between the customer and the service remains fully encrypted. We only get a secondary flow of the traffic that is unencrypted when it comes to our engine or our collector.
Okay. All right, great. Michael also has a question about, he says, it seems like what's most needed is dynamic API response, similar to how UTMs were impactful to firewalls. It's an interesting comment. Any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, I think so. So one of the issues that we run into when we talk about APIs is that we have many, many standards and many, many protocols. So APIs have been around a while. So actually since the 1960s, if you want to become theoretical about it. But, you know, since the early 2000s, that's sort of when REST was developed at UC Berkeley, Irvine. Facebook created things like GraphQL and so on. Google created gRPC. So we have these many, many types of protocols which behave in a different manner. So it's really hard to secure that dynamic nature of those APIs because you cannot really predict what is happening. So for example, with a GraphQL API, you have typically a single endpoint, not multiple endpoints as you would have with REST. And that single endpoint responds on the basis of the query you provide to the endpoint. So now put a firewall in between and ask that firewall to catch all of those, let's say, outliers and use cases if you can't even predict what the logic that is allowed on that endpoint looks like and what the data that can be exchanged looks like. So that's really the difficulty that we have to deal with today.
Okay. All right, great. So there's a question from Dan wondering, you know, what kind of load the API discovery process places on server infrastructure.
So basically the only impact that would be generated from a production environment, so I'm differentiating between the pre-production and the production. In the pre-production with the active testing, you would see active calls towards that endpoint, but it wouldn't be significant, right? It's a couple of calls towards the endpoint, so there's no load increase to speak of. From the production point of view, because we take a flow, an additional flow through a gateway system or a firewall or something like that, the additional pressure would be on that device. So that device gives us an additional flow of the traffic. So there's no impact on production systems whatsoever on the application side. The additional load, and we're talking a few percentage points, would be on those inline devices that have to spin off a copy of the flow towards our environment. But usually, the performance envelope of these systems is like there's so much headroom that it doesn't impact at all.
Okay. All right. Super. Well, we've probably got time for, you know, one more question. And here's another good one that came in. How do we protect our APIs from malicious traffic? You know, so that's a broad question, but I guess I wonder, you know, what are sort of the best practices that you guys see, and you know, what have you built into the no name, you know, tool set to address those top things?
Yeah, so I think just with anything, if we talk about security, it's always about defense in depth and layered approach. And I think that's valid for APIs as well. So that's also one of the reasons why we say the existing investments that you made in a tool like a gateway or a web application firewall are still going to be super valuable, because that is where you would implement things like authentication and authorization controls through those gateway systems to make sure that only authenticated and authorized users can make use of your system. And then you have a dedicated platform like a no name augmenting that functionality to really understand what the capabilities of the application are. What is the logic that is allowed through that application? And how can we differentiate between good behavior versus bad behavior? So it's really about a layered approach and connecting all of these systems together. So you really have to go through, as an attacker, through all of the layers of the onion, so to speak, before you reach the middle interesting point. And you have to have these systems work together. The only way, in my humble opinion, to really detect these types of malicious attempts against APIs is by using things like machine learning. So we employ machine learning to really understand what good behavior looks like. And once we understand good behavior, we can easily spot bad behavior. Because once we understand the baseline, this is what a normal user would do, we can very easily spot an outlier to that baseline and say, this is malicious traffic. Now ask the firewall to block that user, for example. So that's really how I think you should think through it, as a defense in depth and layered approach.
Okay. Thanks. Appreciate that context there. So, Philip, just thank you for putting together a really informative presentation and for all your insights here in the Q&A. We really appreciate your time today.
Yeah, thanks very much, Kat. My pleasure.
All right. And so just a quick reminder that those resources are available in your handout section. Again, it's the no name overview, a white paper on shift left API security testing, and a API security testing for dummies book. And also we will make sure that the demo is visible in the recording of the, of the presentation. So you'll get an email in a couple of days with a link to view a replay. If you do want to see the demo, you'll be able to, and you weren't able to see it today, you'll be able to go in there and see it there. So we do have one more piece of business here today before we wrap up. It's the Amazon gift card prize drawing. And the winner of the $300 Amazon gift card today is Warren Torino from Massachusetts. So congratulations to Warren. We'll be in touch to get you your card. And with that, on behalf of the Actual Tech Media team, I want to thank No Name Security for making this event possible. And thanks, as always, for attending and for your great questions. That concludes today's event. Have a fantastic rest of your day.